Hey, Faith family. This is Pastor Aaron here. Quick announcement that today's service is actually last week's service. So we recorded it as we were able to gather together in person. And it seems like the video and the audio recorded well, so we wanted to share that this week. So please note that the announcements are off a week. Primarily, the time of prayer with Zion Baptist will be at their church at noon. And let me know if you'd like to join and I can get you instructions for that. We'll likely, as long as the weather works out, we will be meeting outside so it's easier for us to connect and to pray and to fellowship together. So that's at Zion Baptist at noon on Monday. Otherwise, all the announcements, or the rest of the announcements, are up to date. And Jen does a wonderful job of giving you a context about that announcement. So you are loved, you are missed, and you are prayed for. We're looking forward to continuing to connect with more and more individuals, although we know that some are not able to join for a time being, and we want to continue to stay connected with you. So we understand that. We'll continue to put these services together and put them out electronically so that you can worship with us as we grow in faith together. God bless you. We love you all. Hopefully see you again soon.
Good morning and welcome to Faith Baptist Church. I have to tell you, we've been having our staff meetings in here and so that we can physically distance, and it's a little lonely, so I'm glad to see everybody after a few months. It's been a little bit lonely around here. As you have probably already observed and experienced, our services are a little bit different right now. The reintegration team has been working to provide an experience that is safe but still allows us to meet together. And so we appreciate your flexibility with all the requirements that we have. We've also modified the format a little bit, and the service will be shorter. If you have kids, hopefully you were able to grab one of the coloring sheets in the box of crayons as you came in. And we would encourage you, kids, to work on those during the service. And then we ask that you leave them with us when you leave, because we'd like to make a display. The coloring sheet today says, "I believe." And we're beginning a sermon series, teaching series on the Apostles' Creed. And so we want to be able to create a mural of sorts with your artwork. So leave your crayons, leave your artwork on the table when you leave. We also, along with that series, are offering everybody, not just kids, the opportunity to get an ice cream cone. Who likes ice cream cones? I like ice cream cones. If you memorize the Apostles' Creed during this teaching series, you can get an ice cream cone from Corner Coffee. So there'll be more about that in the next couple of weeks. But again, if you practice and learn the Apostles' Creed, you can get an ice cream cone. Finally, our announcement this week, apart from all the changes and the way things look different, actually I got to back up one more thing. One of the things that's missing in the service is the opportunity to greet one another during shake break. And we know that that's an important time for some people to catch up. So after the service, you'll be dismissed by an usher who will lead you out. We ask that you exit the building quickly, but we've blocked off the parking lot to provide ample space for people to talk following the service. We do ask when you do that, masks are optional because it's outside, but please, please, please maintain 6 feet of physical distance between you and other households. That allows everybody to participate in the conversation and feel comfortable, and it also provides a witness to our neighborhood that's watching. They know we're meeting today, and if we're out there all close and huddled up together, it doesn't really communicate a sense of caring for our neighborhood. So maintain that physical distance, but catch up with people around you. Finally, on Monday, the group of us, since the unrest in Minneapolis, have been meeting. Pastor Aaron and Pastor Brian Heron from Zion Baptist Church, it's about 3 miles south of here, and it's a predominantly African-American congregation, have been meeting over the last couple of years and meeting together for prayer. And every time they meet, they think, what can we do to bring our congregations together? Well, the recent events in Minneapolis made it very clear to them that the way to serve is by just meeting together in prayer. So for the last several Mondays, a group from Zion and a group from Faith have been meeting to pray. We started meeting in Zion, And then we met at Faith, alternating weeks. Last week, we met outside in a park that's near Zion Baptist. And this week, tomorrow, we're going to meet on the lot that's right there, where the house was. And we're going to meet, we're going to pray, and we're going to walk to Lori and pray for our community. If you're interested in participating in that and need more details, just talk to Pastor Aaron or I. We meet at noon again this week. It's on the lot right next to Faith, and it's always done by 1 o'clock. So it's the kind of thing that you can participate in over your lunch hour and still get back to work. So those are all of our announcements. I would just encourage you to really consider coming to that time. I know for me personally, it's really been it's been personally challenging, and it's also been encouraging. Because God calls us to be ministers of reconciliation, and to see that play out in prayer and praise to God has been a beautiful thing. So I would encourage you to attend. All right, let's get started.
This is the most coveted spot here in the church, because you can unmask yourself and breathe easy. So so good to see you all. Predictions today was one I would break down in tears, so that was one of the predictions, so trying to get that out of the way. And then two, that see this little recording device, we're trying to see how service will look. Prediction is, since I've spent the last 3 months looking at a phone, I might just start doing this. So if I do, just start waving and say, hey, we're actually here, don't just talk to the iPhone. So thanks for dealing with this last 3 months and engaging online and communicating and doing the best that we can during this very difficult season to love and to serve one another. So we have an opportunity today, as we kind of modified the service a little bit, to recite together the call to worship. Would you stand for the call to worship from Psalm 145? We're going to recite that together. I'll say the first line, and you'll repeat with the second one. Psalm 145. I will extol you, my God and King, and bless your name forever and ever.
Every day I will bless you and praise your name forever and ever.
Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised, and his greatness is unsearchable.
One generation shall remember your works in your heart, and shall declare your mighty acts.
On the glorious splendor of your majesty and on your wondrous works, I will meditate. They shall pour forth the fame of your abundant goodness and shall sing aloud of your righteousness.
The Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love.
The Lord is good to all, and his mercy is over all that he has made.
All your works shall give thanks to you, Lord, and all your saints shall bless you.
They shall speak of the glory of your kingdom and tell of your power, to make known to the children of man your mighty deeds and the glorious splendor of your kingdom. You may be seated as we continue with the video from Emily and a first song.
Good morning, Faith Baptist Church. It's Emily here. I wish that I could be with you this morning, but it will be just a few more weeks before I'm able to return. However, Dustin and I had the great privilege of singing your first worship song this morning, so we hope that you enjoy. And before we play that, I have a very unusual request to ask of you. This is not my heart at all, and it seems a very unusual request for a worship leader, but I have to ask you this morning not to sing with us. This church has committed to following the best guidelines during this season to keep everyone safe, and unfortunately, that means that we cannot sing together right now inside in corporate worship. And while that is heartbreaking, I think it also draws us to seek the Lord in a new way. So while you are listening to the songs this morning, we ask you to pray, to really focus on what these words mean that you hear. I think sometimes we discover new worship when we really stop and take time and listen to the words that we are proclaiming. And I look forward to being able to worship with you again. And And then I just really hope that God is so glorified this morning and that your time will be truly blessed. So I miss you all. Hope to see you soon. And I hope that you enjoy this morning's worship.
There's three things we took into consideration. One, we wanted some continuity with the way things have were before. So some continuity to what we were doing as a church or our way of worship back in March. So we know not all that continuity can happen. And you didn't have a bulletin or order of service, but you'll see that we're trying to work through some some similar order that we used to do. We've also tried to provide good content. We haven't been able to gather together, so we want to make sure that there's good content as we come together based on God's Word, and an opportunity for community. I know we're all masked and 6 feet apart, but there is an opportunity to degree, to interact, to be together. And so that's kind of the guidelines that we use, or along with the guidelines from the CDC, to put this service together. So right now we want to turn to a time of prayer. Down the road, that might be a turn in time of personal prayer requests, opportunity to hear some praise reports. Today we just wanted to start with a time of prayer for us together. So would you bow your heads as we gather together? Heavenly Father, I just look around this room and I know some of the stories, what people have experienced these last 3 months. Lord, we also look around the room and we know that many aren't able to join at this time and in this place. And so we know their stories as well. But what is common amidst all of us right now, Lord, is, Lord, that you are faithful. And we praise you for your continued faithfulness. We praise you as our emotions have gone up and down, our abilities, we feel like we can't move ahead, our relationships have been affected. There's been so much change. And they say that the only constant right now is change, that what's next, what's going to change next. And yet, we are reminded, Father, that you are faithful, that your love is steadfast, that you are the Alpha and the Omega. You are the God in whom we can trust, not just a little bit, but entirely. Lord, we praise you for that. We praise you that in the midst of this world that is changing and our lives that have been up and down, that you are faithful and that you have sustained us. Lord, you've sustained us through Jesus Christ. Lord, we thank you for Christ. We thank you that we do not walk alone. We are reminded more and more of our need for our Savior. We are reminded more and more without the buffers that we've had around us and the relationships and being able to gather together, we are reminded of how much we need Jesus to sustain us. That when all else is taken away, that he is still there. That when life is a desert, when the storms hit, he is the one who stills the storm, who calms our heart, who provides in abundance. Lord, we praise you for Christ. Lord, we ask for more of your Holy Spirit to pour out. The Spirit that creates, the Spirit that sustains, the Spirit that knits our hearts together, though we are separated by distance right now. Lord, your word talks about this yearning for one another and how good and how pleasant it is for brothers and sisters to dwell together in unity. Lord, our hearts yearn right now for those that we're not able to connect with. Lord, so many stories of grandmas and grandpas who can't visit the kids and friends who can't connect and workplaces affected and communities. Lord, we yearn to gather again. Lord, keep our hearts longing for that. And we pray. We pray for this situation. We continue to pray for those who are serving in the medical community. Many connected to faith are doing that. Lord, we lift up the nurses and the doctors. We lift up those who are serving in that area. Lord, your word calls us to pray for our rulers and authorities, and we pray right now for those. From the national level, to the state, to the local level, there has been so much going on. Lord, we ask that you would guide them, that you would give them wisdom, that there be clear direction as they seek to put about a place of safety and security. Lord, and even as we pray that, we are reminded that our ultimate safety and security is found in Jesus. Lord, we pray that as we move forward, that you would continue to knit our hearts together. That as we move forward, you would continue to shape in us a great love that continues to abound more and more. That we would be people with wisdom and knowledge and discernment. That we would continue to seek holiness and purity. That we would be filled again with the fruit of righteousness that comes through Jesus Christ. We pray this in his name. Amen. We are going to continue with the time of offering. Obviously, we're not going to have ushers and we're not going to pass a plate. But during this time of offering, in addition to reflecting on the words of the song, encourage you to reflect on how you might give of your time, talent, and treasure this upcoming week. If you give online or if you hadn't set that up, this is an opportunity to do that. There is also an offering box in the back, and when you leave, you can give or cash a check if you so desire as you walk out today. But please, again, not during this service. Straighten my tie a little bit and adjust based on this bulletproof glass. So don't test its stability, please, all right? I don't know how strong it is, so don't throw anything or push the limits here a little bit. So up in Aiken, my in-laws have a cabin. And for the last year or so, when I get up there, there's a set of two kayaks. And they're smaller kayaks, they're green on the top, white on the bottom. And every time I get up there, my kids get in there, no problem. But I'm about to get in there and everybody's like, Aaron, don't do that. And I say, don't worry. I believe that this kayak is gonna hold me up. I believe it'll be just fine. But the kids know, and everybody else knows what I should know, that even though I believe it will hold me up, the fact that I'm a relatively large man and these kayaks are pretty small, just because I believe I won't get wet doesn't mean I won't get wet, because the object that I'm believing in is a little bit lighter than it needs to be. So I'll step into that kayak and the water will go all the way up to the perfect line, you know? That just says, all right, I'm fine, until I put the paddle out and start moving a little bit, and then the water comes rushing in. And I'm wet, which is fine during the summer, but when I do it in the fall and the spring, there's usually a nice shriek. I was like, ah! And everybody's like, I told you so. Well, I can believe that kayak as hard as I want, but if that kayak isn't strong enough or stable enough, it's not going to hold me up. And I can believe that the kayak is just fine, but if I take that kayak out in the middle of a storm, I'm gonna sink, no matter how much I believe. Well, I don't know about you, but have you been watching the news lately? Have you been following along on Instagram or Facebook or Twitter? Have you been talking with people? What's everybody saying? I believe this political party. I believe this politician. I believe this article. I believe, I believe, I believe. There's a cacophony of people saying, I believe. There's a cacophony of people saying, I believe in the American dream. I believe this is what should happen. But in the midst of that cacophony, my question is, what are we believing in? And does it support us? Does it provide strength for more than just a brief opinion? Is it solid? And this morning I want to start a series on the Apostles' Creed, because what I contend that as Christians, instead of saying, I believe in the American dream, that as Christians we would do much better. In fact, we would be biblically grounded to say, I believe in the truth of the Apostles' Creed, and I'm seeking to live it. Let me show you why. Romans chapter 10, verses 8 through 9. If you have your cell phones or brought a Bible, there are no pew Bibles for the moment. But if you look at Romans 10, 8 through 9, Paul writes, he says that the word is near to you, in your mouth and in your heart. That is the word of faith that we proclaim. Because if we confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. The scripture teaches us, and most of us know this by memory, the importance of belief. That if we believe in Jesus Christ, and I think this passage talks a little bit about believing and living. Those are linked together. You can't just confess it with your lips. You have to believe it in your heart. It's not just words, but it's also deeds. You only live up to your belief. What this passage is saying is belief is of utmost importance, because if you do not believe, you will not be saved. Belief changes everything. Belief is transformative. But belief in the wrong thing can make you more than just getting a little wet. It can lead to a catastrophe. To say, I believe this is going to hold me up, and a storm hits and you sink. Or to say, I believe I should do this, but it's not grounded in truth. That can lead to disaster. But to say you believe and it's grounded in truth can lead to wonderful, life-changing experiences. Think through your life. Many of you have experienced this scripture yourself. I believe in Jesus Christ, and your life has been transformed. I think through our journey with Noelle and myself, like, I believe I'm in love with Noelle. That's transformed my life, because thankfully she said, I believe I'm in love with you too. If that wouldn't have been consistent, our life wouldn't be anywhere near what it is. In fact, it would have been a disaster. It'd be all wet, all washed up without her. The same thing about faith. This is year 5. You put up with me for 5 years. Thank you all. 5 years. But if I would have said, I believe that God has called us to Faith Baptist Church to serve as the senior pastor here in North Minneapolis, and you all didn't return an email, like, doesn't matter how much I believe that, if he wouldn't have emailed me back or called me back, it wouldn't have been life-changing. It would have been a big disappointment on my part. Romans 10, 8 through 9 is talking about the importance of belief and the object of our belief, that we must believe in Jesus Christ. But let me ask you, in this cacophony of voices out there in this world, do you understand who Jesus is? Do your neighbors, when you share, I'm a follower of Jesus, do they know what that means? Do they understand what that means? Or do they think it's just like a political party?
Do they understand that you live and breathe based on Jesus Christ and that shapes everything you do? Or do they believe that Jesus is just a myth along with Hercules and Zeus and whatever other myth out there? Do they understand what you believe in? See, in the cacophony of voices and opinions and belief, we need something to stand upon. And 2,000 years ago in early church history, when Paul said that you must believe in Jesus Christ, he also said this is in accordance with the rule of faith, or the word of faith, if you look in verse 8. This word of faith backed up or provided substance to what belief in Jesus entailed. It kind of explained, when you say I believe in Jesus, that Jesus is God's Son, that Jesus is fully God, fully human, that Jesus came for a purpose, the life he lived, the death he died, the resurrection, his resurrection is for a purpose. It's not just sitting out here, not attached to anything, that our belief is grounded in this historical truth, this word of faith. And so what is that? What do we ground ourselves to? Again, 2,000 years ago, there was a lot of controversy. Well, that Jesus Christ, we only believe the spiritual Jesus, the Gnostic Jesus, that he didn't really come in the flesh, that he just came to guide us away from this evil world. And those who have this special insight and wisdom are those who understand that. Others argued that, well, he wasn't really fully divine. He was or fully human, or others said, well, 2,000 years ago, well, the God of creation is different than the God of redemption, and they battled this out. There was a lot of controversy. There was a huge cacophony of political and religious and different views. In other words, there was a lot of people saying, I believe this, I believe that. But the early church leaned upon God's word. And he said, let's lay out what God's word teaches us in a clear and concise way so that we have guidance as we start to explain to people, so that we have direction in the midst of this confusion, so we have a means to educate the next generation and our pagan neighbor. And so that's why I wanted to turn to the Apostles' Creed, because this is what the church developed initially. And it started in the 200s, they worked through this. The wording we have today is from the 800s, and it's a guide for us to be able to understand what we believe in. And so I'm going to read it this morning. At the end of this short message, I'm going to have you all recite it, but I'm going to read it to you, and then we'll continue. So this is the Apostles' Creed. It's in your handout if you want to follow along. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, the Creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. The third day He rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty, whence He shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Universal Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The reason I want to study that here this summer is because this provides us clarity in this midst of confusion right now. There is so much confusion out here. It provides us clarity as what is essential for us as Christians to believe. It provides for us clear guidance. It's like I was going to hold up my phone, but it's attached over there. It's like using a GPS map. I love Apple Maps or Google Maps or Waze. It provides a navigation to how to get somewhere, so we're not just out blindly trying to figure it out, or even a place that we're familiar with, but trying to do it from memory. Sometimes we get lost and we forget. So it provides a guide amidst this time of war, this world of confusion. The Apostles' Creed provides a clear guidance of what's essential, what we need to hold true to, what we're willing to really die for, what defines us. In the Apostles' Creed, it contains what I believe, it contains what we as basic our basic beliefs that we should not believe less than what it says and be a Christian. We can believe more, we should believe more, but it's hard to believe less than that and say you are a Christian. But just like Google Maps or Waze, it's a tool. And reality defines how it's used. So even if you do Google Maps and you try to go along a road and the sign on the road says road closed and Google Maps says go ahead, which do? You listen to Google Maps or do you deal with reality? Usually I deal with reality. Every once in a while, I bet I can get around this. But if you're smart, you deal with reality and you follow the signs. Same thing with the Apostles' Creed. It's a tool. It maps onto the reality of God's Word. So there's places where you might go, I don't know, but trust in God's Word, not in the Apostles' Creed. But the Apostles' Creed guides us to this, to what is true. It also provides us concise teaching. We haven't met in 3 months. You've been listening to sermons online. You've probably seen lots of books and articles and this is what you need to do, and this is what you need to read. And if you have kids, you're like, okay, I used to have Sunday school, a youth group, and Awana. How do I instruct and teach my kids? This is provides clear and concise teaching. If you look at the creed, it talks about creation, fall, redemption, restoration. It talks about eternity to eternity. The God who creates, God the Father. It talks about God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. It gives us a framework to be able to study and learn and to teach. So when you talk to your neighbor and you can say, this I believe, you can say to your neighbor, what do you believe? Oh, you believe in natural selection and the survival of the fittest? I believe in God the Father Almighty, the creator of heaven and earth, the one who made each one of us in his image. That's why every race has value. That's why every culture, every person from every culture has dignity. That's why I stand for the marginalized. You can begin to evangelize. You can also begin to disciple your children, your youth, those you're working with. This is what I believe. Where do you struggle? Do you have any doubts you want to talk about? Do you wrestle with this? This is what I wrestled with for many years. And you can begin to converse if you have this framework for understanding. I think of it kind of like, who here has read or listened to Harry Potter? All right. We've been doing a lot of books listening during this COVID season. And Harry Potter's been one of those. Imagine trying to listen to Harry Potter, listen to it on shuffle. Shuffle mode. You know that mode? Just kind of random. Could you figure out what was going on? Okay, wait. Hermione and Ron, wait. Are they at Hogwarts? Wait, I thought, well, who's this Dobby character? Wait, Snape's good? Bad? Like, you would be completely confused. But if you have this table of contents, if you have this framework, if you have this understanding, then you can go, oh, okay, that's this chapter they're talking about. This happens after Hogwarts was invaded. All those different understandings. You see how the creed can give us a framework for, this is talking about creation. This is talking about redemption. This is talking about resurrection. And to begin to lay out how we think and understand the Christian faith. And today, just as I close, these are shorter messages, hopefully interactive. I started with, I believe. I believe. First of all, this is an I statement. This is something that you have to say, that this is what I believe. If you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your hearts, you will be saved. But it's also something that we say together. This creed goes back 2,000 years. Isn't that encouraging that my grandma Garls, who has passed away many years ago, this draws a memory that she has said these same words. And that as we gather with friends and family who are virtual right now, that they're saying these same words. That as we're trying to navigate this world of issues and divisions, that we can say, no, we have unity here because we believe together in God the Almighty and Jesus Christ and the power of the Holy Spirit. You see the power of the unity as it draws us together. This tells us what we are willing to die on. Friends, don't die on the American dream, but die on what the Apostles' Creed teaches us about Jesus Christ. And it also tells us how we need to believe, or what we should be believing. It gives us knowledge to live. See, belief is not just saying something, it's what we live. We're called to contend for the faith. The truths of this should be all-encompassing. They should permeate every part of who we are. And it should shape our emotions and our thoughts and our feelings. And then anybody else had one of these pandemic dreams? Did you hear about that? Have you experienced that? The dreams were pretty intense during the pandemic because we were out of our routine and rhythm. I had a number of intense dreams, and they usually involve me being underprepared in my outfits. Okay. Underprepared in my studies. For some reason, I kept on going back to school in my dreams. And underprepared in my sermon. So even though we weren't meeting, I kept on envisioning that we were meeting. And I would wake up from those dreams going, being a little anxious and a little bit, I don't feel very good, and a little bit sheepish. Oh, that just doesn't sit well. And then I would have to tell myself, no, I believe that if you ever go out in public, you would wear appropriate clothes. All right, I believe that's who I am as Aaron. All right, I believe that if I was to take a test, I would have prepared ahead of time. And I believe that if we ever gather again, which we have, hallelujah, that I would have prepared, and even if I didn't, I would have meditated on God's word enough that in season or out of season, I would be prepared to give an answer for the reason, the hope that I have. Okay, I feel much better. I had to talk through the truth of what I believe, not what I felt or dreamt. And friends, it's the same way. When this pandemic going on, you can wonder, you can worry, but let this shape you. I believe in God the Almighty, the creator of heaven and earth. Why am I worried? Why am I anxious? I believe in Jesus Christ who gave his life for me. I believe in the resurrection of the dead. I believe in the life to come. Let that seep in. I believe in the power of the Holy Spirit and the forgiveness of sins. I can move forward amidst my failures and my shortcomings. I believe that the church is universal and it's together. And even though we're separate, I believe that the church hasn't been closed. Do you see how important it is to know what you believe and to live it? So would you stand as we recite this together, as we close? I believe in God, the Father Almighty, the Creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. The third day He rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty, whence He shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Universal Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated as we close with the song from Brenda and Kara and Kyle playing. Thank you.
May his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May he look upon each and every one of you with favor and give you peace, now and always. Amen. All right, don't leave till you're ushered out, and you'll be ushered out. You can fellowship in the parking lot if you so choose. So Penny's in charge of dismissal.